Hey everybody, this is Chemical Equilibrium for AP Chemistry in 10 minutes or less. This video is meant as a refresher on some of the major topics in Unit 7 of the 2021 version of AP Chemistry. It is intended for students who have already learned the material and are beginning to prepare for the AP Chemistry exam. For anyone that cares, it's going to cover the following topics from the AP Chemistry course and exam description. Let's get started. Now, equilibrium itself can be a difficult concept, so let's begin by tackling what exactly we mean by chemical equilibrium. First of all, for chemical equilibrium to exist, we need a special type of reaction known as a reversible reaction, where you have reactants that are turning into products, but simultaneously those products are turning back into reactants. These types of chemical reactions will eventually reach a point where the rate that the reactants are turning into products will equal the rate that the products are turning into the reactants, and at that point, you'll no longer observe any changes in the amounts of reactants or products. This state where no further change is observed is called chemical equilibrium. We can see that expressed graphically on a rate versus time graph. If your reaction starts out with lots of reactants and essentially no products, then at the beginning of the reaction, the forward reaction rate is going to be relatively fast. That's because there's lots of reactants to react. As time goes on, however, the rate of that forward reaction will get slower and slower and slower. At the same time, the reverse reaction, which is the products changing back into reactants, starts relatively slow, but will increase in speed as time goes on until the two rates meet. When the rate of the forward reaction equals the rate of the reverse reaction, you have reached equilibrium, and now the amounts of reactants and the amounts of products will no longer change. We can also see this equilibrium form by looking at the concentrations of the reactants and the products themselves. Again, if I have lots of reactants at the beginning, they will decrease as this reaction goes on, but eventually level off, and no further change will be observed. At some point, that's when equilibrium has been achieved. In that same time, the amounts of products that we started with, essentially none of, will slowly increase, but again, leveling off and not changing anymore once equilibrium has been established. It's also possible for other reactions to look a little bit different when they reach equilibrium. You could start off with lots of reactants, but as equilibrium is reached, the reactants don't actually decrease all that much. At the same time, the products, you might make some products, but very few amounts. So when equilibrium has been achieved, there's actually still more reactants than there are products. This first graph represents a product-favored equilibrium reaction, and the second graph represents a reactant-favored equilibrium reaction. One helpful thing about equilibrium is that when a reaction reaches that equilibrium state, it will always have the same ratio of products to reactants at a given temperature. This ratio is written in a standard format with the products in the numerator, the product amounts at equilibrium, divided by the reactant amounts at equilibrium. Setting up this ratio is called an equilibrium expression, and if you calculate the value, it's symbolized with a capital K and is known as the equilibrium constant. For product-favored reactions, since there are more products at equilibrium, you'll have a K value that is much greater than 1. Whereas in a reactant-favored reaction, the K value will be much less than 1. Here's some additional details on writing equilibrium expressions. If my reaction is X changing into 2Ys, then I would write the equilibrium expression with Y on top and X on the bottom. Specifically though, the values that you typically plug in, as long as X and Y are aqueous, that means they're dissolved in water, we would actually use the concentration of Y at equilibrium and the concentration of X at equilibrium. We're also going to take any coefficients like the 2 in front of Y, and that becomes an exponent in the equilibrium expression. The coefficient with X is a 1, so X is raised to the first power. The equilibrium constant for this expression is a capital K, of course, sometimes expressed with a lowercase c or a sub c, the c representing the fact that we used concentrations. If X and Y were both gases, you could also write the equilibrium expression using partial pressures and call it a K sub P. In either type of expression, we're going to exclude any solids and any liquids. In AP Chem, you'll come across lots of other types of KCs, like KA, the acid dissociation constant, or KB, the base dissociation constant, or KW, the equilibrium constant for the auto-ionization of water, or KSP, which we'll talk about later in this video. It's important to remember that even though there's all these different versions, they're all just different types of KC expressions, and they follow the exact same rules. And finally, let's look at some properties of these equilibrium constants and expressions. I've written our original reaction X changing into 2Y in three different ways down here in the bottom right hand corner. This first reaction is simply the reverse or the opposite of the original, and it's going to have a different K value as a result. This new K value that I've denoted as K sub 2 will be the inverse of the original K, let's call it K sub 1. The second form of the reaction is the same as the original, except it's been multiplied by a coefficient factor of 2. It's also going to have a new K value that I've denoted with a K sub 3. This K sub 3 is going to be equal to the original K, K sub 1, raised to the exponent of whatever I multiplied the reaction by. In this case, I multiplied the reaction by 2, so my K1 has to be squared to equal the new K value. And in the third example, I've got two different reactions that I can add together because they have a common intermediate 2y that's going to be canceled off. This results in a new net reaction, x changing into z. The k value for that net reaction will be k1 times k4. If you have to perform quantitative calculations for the amounts of reactants and products in an equilibrium reaction, there's a helpful method to do that that employs something called an ice table. So to set up an ice table, we'll take our reversible equilibrium reaction. Beneath that, set up three rows, I, C, and E. The I stands for initial, C stands for change, E stands for equilibrium. You'll fill it out by simply plugging in the initial amounts of reactants and products. Usually at the beginning, there's some products, but no reactants. Those reactants will decrease, so in my change column, I'll represent the decrease with a minus sign, while the products are going to increase, represented with a plus sign. Those changes will also follow the stoichiometric ratios in the reaction. Since my coefficient with R is 1, this is decreasing by 1x. Since the coefficient with P is also 1, the products are increasing by 1x. So at equilibrium, I know my reactant amount is 0.5 minus some quantity x, while the product amount is simply that quantity x. And there's lots of different ways you can use an ice table, but in almost all of them, you'll take whatever is plugged in that equilibrium row and plug that into your K expression. When you're doing any math with this, just remember that if your K value is a KC, then you have to use molarities in your ice table. If your K value is a KP, then you should be using partial pressures. There's also some really helpful algebraic tricks to remember when you're solving these expressions, like removing any minus X's or plus X's if your K value is really, really, really small. Or if the K value is really large, then you can assume that it essentially goes to completion. Ignore the ice table entirely and just do your normal stoichiometric methods. Treat it essentially as if it was a forward arrow only. If you've got a set of concentrations or pressures and you're not sure if those concentrations or pressures are the equilibrium values, you can test to see if they are using something called the reaction quotient, capital Q. To solve for Q, you simply plug the values in for the typical equilibrium expression written the same way as we talked about before. You just can't call it a value for K because, again, we're not sure if those concentrations are the equilibrium ones or not. If you calculate the value of Q and it is equal to K, then of course those concentrations or pressures were at equilibrium. If the Q value is larger than the value for K, that means there's too many products and the reaction has to go in reverse to reach equilibrium. And if the Q was less than K, that means you don't have enough products or you've got too many reactants. The reaction has to go forward to reach equilibrium in that scenario. You can also take a system that is at equilibrium and stress or disturb that equilibrium by changing one or more variables. That system is going to respond to get back to equilibrium. This is described by Le Chatelier's principle. So let's say I've got this endothermic reaction shown here, and it is already at equilibrium. One way I can disturb that equilibrium is by suddenly adding in additional particles of A. That's going to cause the value for Q to decrease, which means the reaction has to go in the forward direction to reach equilibrium again, or shift to the right, according to Le Chatelier's principle. You'll sometimes see these disturbances graphed on a concentration versus time graph. You can see here where A was suddenly added to an equilibrium mixture. After the shift, equilibrium is restored again. A temperature change, like increasing the temperature, will also cause a shift in the equilibrium mixture. In this case, since the reaction is endothermic, it's going to cause a shift to the right. And unique to temperature changes, besides causing a shift left or shift right, the value for K itself will change here. Since we're making more products, the value for K will increase. Another way to shift this equilibrium is to decrease the volume of the container. Since they're gases, that's going to raise the pressure. To decrease that pressure again, the reaction will shift towards whichever side has less moles of gas, in this case, shifting to the right. This is also a good time to talk a little bit more about a special equilibrium expression for a special type of reaction called the solubility product constant, or KSP. This is simply a special title given to the equilibrium constant value that's associated with a salt that has dissolved in an aqueous solution and has fully saturated the solution. When that saturation takes place, the solid salt is in equilibrium with its dissolved aqueous ions. So for a sample salt, let's just call it MX, the equation or the reaction equation would look like this, and the K value for this equation could be called KSP. KSP is often used as an indicator of a salt's solubility. The larger the KSP value is, the more products there are, which means the salt is more soluble. It's important to remember that a KSP is a K just like any other K value, and you can use ice tables for these reactions, or write K expressions or sulfur Q, or even apply Le Chatelier's principle just as you would for other reactions. There is one other special use of a KSP. You can use it to decide if a certain solid salt will form as a precipitate. To do that, you'll simply solve for the Q value, the reaction quotient, based on the concentrations of the ions in the solution. If that Q value is greater than the KSP, a precipitate will form. If, however, the Q value is less than KSP, there aren't enough ions to form the solid, you will not get a precipitate. There's also something called the common ion effect that describes a scenario where my sample salt MX is being dissolved in a solution that already contains some M+, or some X minus ions. So let's say I'm trying to dissolve some MX in a solution that already contains some X minus. That's gonna be reflected in your ice table by not having zero plugged in for the initial row. Instead, you'll plug in whatever concentration of X minus ions were already in that solution. This will have the overall effect of decreasing the solubility of MX. And that wraps it up for Chemical Equilibrium for AP Chemistry in 10-ish minutes or less. Thanks for watching.